every other day.
So you go to the gym every day too?
Yeah, unless we're shooting.
Feel my chest.
Oh, nice.
All right, eh?
Far away.
You don't happen to know cameras are rolling, do you?
You think wedding ring on or off? What do you want out of this show? That's the question.
That's gotta be the open of this show.
Welcome to Mike on Much. I am your host, Mike Veerman. This is my friend and trusted producer, Max Kerman.
Yo.
This is our pop culture aficionado, Shane Cunningham.
Yo, yo.
Today on our episode, we have Jared Keeso, the star of Letterkenny, which is also on Crave TV, since we are sitting here on Crave TV right now. And in the digital dessert, we have pop musician, Jason Mraz.
That's right. It's a good one.
But I'm glad we're here. We have Jared on the show. Typically, we ask the big wigs at Bell Media to get us interviews. And they have, to be fair, supplied probably, I don't know, 96% of the interviews.
Yeah, they got the contacts. That's how you get a sting.
But occasionally, they can't come through. And when we asked for Letterkenny, they said,
he's too big.
He's too big. Yeah. Jared doesn't do every interview. But luckily, I have a bit of a relationship with Jared. Mm-hmm. I sent him a text, and he agreed to come down and do it, which was very cool. The way I know Jared, it actually started about 2 years ago in Montreal, the band was on tour with Frank Turner, and we've had Frank on the podcast
before. Of course, yeah.
And Frank's a very charming British guy with a very, kind of like an intense fan base. Like they love Frank and will follow Frank to the ends of the world to see his shows. So Frank was on tour with us, opening for Arkells. Frank is also the kind of guy that likes to play like 3 to 4 shows per day. Like when he's on tour, it's like a very, he loves to work. He loves to perform.
He's like Springsteen.
He is like Springsteen. And like he's sort of my role model, actually, when it comes to like a performer. Like I think of myself as a busybody. Frank works probably 15 times harder than me.
Wow.
So we get to Montreal. It's like a very cold, kind of miserable day in the middle of February. And Frank puts out a tweet saying, does anybody want to throw a house party where I can play some songs acoustically? And that's the kind of thing that he does.
Frank would just do that in any city, try to like find a place to play some songs, after party, whatever.
And that's right. And that's, in a sense, how he's built his career. It's like he has slept on every couch in America, basically. Mm-hmm. And now he stays in fancy hotels because he's a bit of a big shot. But coming up, like people have a real personal relationship.
Who's bigger, you or him?
Oh, Frank's much bigger.
Wow.
Yeah, just in height alone.
Yeah, he's a tall guy.
Yeah, 6'4".
Exactly.
This is why the viewers tune in, to see how tall Frank Turner is.
Yeah.
I didn't know he was that tall.
Yeah, tall
That's
guy.
That's cool.
6'3", makes me feel small. So he puts out a tweet and then say, who wants to throw a house party? We can do some acoustic jams. Who comes to the rescue?
Jared Keeso.
Jared Keeso comes to the rescue. Now, here's the thing, is that Frank is from the UK. He's not as familiar with Canadian television. I don't think he knew who Jared Keeso was and what a big deal Jared is. So Jared's like, all right, email me if you want the address. So Frank's fans start emailing him, and he starts handing out Jared's address.
Okay, so does Jared just reply to, was Jared a Frank fan? How does it just reply
Jared
to the text?
Jared is a friend of ours,
yeah.
and through manager
Oh,
Ash.
Did you, oh, okay, so.
And so I think manager Ash put him in touch with Jared, who's usually a very hospitable, accommodating guy, said, yeah, you can do it at my place, which is kind of insane. Because
yeah.
Jared Keeso, I think, is like one of the biggest stars in Canadian, like, entertainment.
Absolutely.
And the fact that he just offered up his very nice Montreal apartment to a bunch of random strangers.
For an after party at a concert?
Really says a lot about the guy. And he's so sweet. So anyway, after we perform, the whole gang of us goes to Jared's apartment. And like one by one, Frank Turner fans just start showing up. And they've traveled from like Boston and Vermont and Toronto just to see Frank. They have no idea that they're at Jared's place. But then Jared's welcoming everybody. He starts handing everybody beer. And literally, that party went on till like 6 in the morning. And Jared and his lovely girlfriend, Mags, like, were super, like, didn't bat an eye. It was so nice of Jared. And he's, like, a very gracious, generous guy, as we've come to know.
Yeah.
And honestly, on that tour, it was one of the most memorable nights. Because it was like, here's this, like, British star who's super hardworking, taking over the like really nice apartment in downtown Montreal of a Canadian entertainment like icon at this point.
Did they trash the place?
I mean, a little bit, but Jared didn't seem to mind.
Well, that reminds me of when we were at Oceaga. Is that how you say it? Oceaga?
Well,
Oceaga.
It happened again.
Well, this is the thing. You guys were playing, Arkells were playing Oceaga, and we were there doing interviews for the podcast. And Jared's like, hey, there's gonna be an after party at my place.
Yeah.
Everybody come. But the thing is, at that day of Oshiega, it rained like crazy. So all of our like shoes are pretty gross. And I was wearing like white, really white sort of tennis shoes, and they got completely dirty. We get to the place and he comes and he answers the door and he's like, it's a shoes on place, it's a shoes on household. Come in, please don't take them off. So I'm like, okay, I'll wear the shoes. And we all wear our shoes, and he has this nice carpet by his like sort of coffee table. And I remember we did a photo with the guys from the podcast. We were like, pod squad, whatever, we take a photo. And the next day when I was looking at the photos, I was like, my God, my shoes are filthy and they're on his nice carpet. And I had this weird, like, I have this like weird guilt, like, Jared's gonna hate me. I just wore the shoes in. And I was like, guys, what do you think? Should I have taken my shoes off? Like, it would have been the nice thing to do to take the shoes off. He was like, he said it was a shoes on house.
I know, and he really means it too. Like his level of generosity.
But I'm like, people just say that. And then much later, I was able to say, Jared, you know, I wore my dirty shoes and it's been eating me ever since that Oshiega. This is like a year later. He's like, no, it's a shoes on household.
Even and icons have maids and rug cleaners.
Yeah, he's not gonna sweat some dirty shoes.
Shane, you were there that night too.
I don't have full memory of that night, but I do have a flashback. Like, Mike passed out on the couch. I knew that at one point. Well, it was kind of like Bernie scenario where everyone was partying around Mike.
It was like one of those things where I'm like, man, this is such a great.
And by the way,
someone was engaged in a full conversation with you, but you were just like out cold.
It's like someone threw some sunglasses on me and put a Pabst in my hand. And
and they were like, Mike's a great listener.
And I was like, oh, okay. Yeah, he's sleeping.
And by the way, for reference, Jared's character on Letterkenny obviously is a little scowly. Like, he kind of has that kind of look. But in real life, it's basically the same thing, but with a grin. That's kind of like.
That's a good way to say it.
He's just kind of like.
And he says please and thank you in the same sentence. You notice that?
Oh, my God, yeah. He's truly...
Like, give us an example.
Yeah.
He'll go, I went out for lunch with him once. This is a little brag. and he ordered what's that drink called? A Caesar. He goes, could I have a Caesar, please, and thank you?
That's a good
move. He did it like that, yeah. Sure. And another time I saw him was outside of a Starbucks, and he was trying to give someone money, but they wouldn't take it.
Like a homeless person?
Well, here's the thing. He's trying to give the person money, and they're like, no, I'm not homeless. But they just looked, like, you know, sometimes you can't tell if it's a homeless person or a hipster.
Oh, yeah.
It was that scenario. And he was getting into, like, a real altercation. I was like, hi, Jared. But, like, over-Canadian-ing it up or whatever. He is the nicest guy in the world.
When the band played in Sudbury, he has a place in Sudbury, and he insisted that he's like, you need to come to my place, take a shower, take a load off. I'm not going to be there. The keys are in the mailbox. Take over the spot. And he, like, had a fridge full of beer. For Letterkenny fans out there who haven't met Jared, he really does live up to every expectation. Because when it comes to like meeting your favorite celebrities.
Well, I think just people in entertainment and sort of creative work or music or acting or anything, you never know what you're gonna get. You don't know if they're gonna be super temperamental. You don't know if they're gonna be super precious or like self-conscious or sort of have an ego. And he completely eschews all of that. He just seems like a dude that would play on your pickup hockey team.
Have you ever met any of your heroes that have let you down?
I met Nirvana, the band, the show, and I interviewed them, and I loved them. I thought they were great. It's just, I think Jay hated me, so I was disappointed that they hated me.
You kind of think everyone hates you, though.
Yeah, I'm usually right, though. Everyone always says, he's very intuitive.
So, I mean, like you said off the top, the fact that we got this interview, I feel like it was kind of rare, because, like, I don't think Jared does a lot of press.
That's what I heard.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, like, we did this here at 299. He came in. Like, honestly, the dude walked over here. Like,
backpack on.
Yeah, every other interview you're going to see on these 8 episodes of our show are, like, people come in. There's always a big setup. He literally just rolled in with a backpack, walked over here on his own.
We had to have him out by 5:30 because he had to catch the train at 6 o'clock.
Totally.
Is he bigger in person or small?
You mean, like, just, like, physically?
Yeah.
He's a fit guy.
Yeah, he's pretty muscular. Do you think he works out a lot? That was the one question.
He has to.
Yeah, but he's also like a hockey player. And I just think that like those natural athletes don't have to work out.
His boss just like that?
I don't know.
Wow.
Do you think he works out?
I mean, he's in pretty good shape.
He's in really good shape. But then where does he
find the time? He probably does 500 push-ups a night.
How many push-ups do you do in it?
I try to do 300.
Are you serious?
Are you kidding?
How do you think I get this physique?
Do 300 a day?
What, you think I just walk out of bed like this?
I heard Kendrick Lamar does 700 a day.
Yeah, I started researching guys who are in really good shape, and it's just push-ups.
That's all?
Yeah.
I do 100, and I think that that's enough. Mm-hmm. And I don't even always do 100 per day.
Interesting.
Do you do any?
So Jared's a guest on the show today. We're all really excited to talk to him. So yeah, we did this just over in the studio down the hall here. We call it the Fishbowl. And I thought it was interesting for a lot of reasons. You were actually on site for this one.
Yeah, I was just there for the photo.
Yeah, so I think Jared's great. Is there anything else we need to set this interview up, guys?
I think the push-up stuff was great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the push-up stuff was your favorite part of the setup?
Yeah.
Now everyone knows your guys' workout regime. So you guys want to get to Jared?
Let's get to it.
Thanks again for doing this, man.
Hey, thanks for
much,
having me.
Much appreciated.
I appreciate it.
And go for it. We're just gonna start.
Outstanding.
That's how we do this.
Okay.
You were actually one of, you and Nate were some of the first guests we ever had when you guys were doing the initial promo for Letterkenny.
Yeah, that was the most fun interview we've ever done too. Dilsey and I agree on that. We talk about it quite a bit, actually.
Well, I think we like, within the first 5 minutes, we were talking Calgary Flames hockey.
Yeah, we were talking backup goaltenders.
You got it, Roman Turek.
Yeah, Dilsey and I had a bit of a tiff over who was in the same conversation as Mike Vernon. He tried to introduce Roman Turek to that conversation.
You weren't having it though.
None of it. He knows better.
You put Turek into a conversation with Alan Bester, I believe.
Yeah, Alan Bester, Peter Ng, Darren Pupa maybe, but not Mike Vernon. He's a cup winner, multiple cup winner.
Well, one of the things that kind of stood out in that interview, and at the time, honestly, that I think resonated with like a lot of people who listened to it, was your outlook sort of on the Canadian industry and sort of making your way here and not having this sort of insatiable need to go down to LA and make things happen there. And I thought it was interesting for a few reasons, just because it is kind of unconventional and unique. And two, like, I guess I was just wondering where you think that mentality comes from in you.
I don't know. I just think there's a loyalty factor that comes along with getting your start in a certain place. And I got my start in Canada. Everything that I've been able to achieve has been on the back of the Canadian industry, and I would like to continue to contribute to that industry and hopefully help others get the same opportunities that I've been lucky enough to get.
Well, I think, like, I guess acting and just creative in general, it's a hard thing to make a career at.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be somebody that's, like, willing to, like, fight for parts, show up, be there.
Yeah.
Are you someone that takes setbacks very difficultly, or are you able to brush it off and keep it moving?
Yeah, I think I think you can only survive in the Canadian industry if you've got some perseverance, if you've got some jam in you, because you're going to hear no so much. So you know, there's definitely disappointments along the way, but you just got to kind of let that roll off your back. And if you're unable to do that, then you won't survive. It's really that simple. You know, you get sick of here. Everybody gets sick of here and know enough, and will, you know, maybe decide they want to try something else. But there's nothing else that I could do.
Do you remember the most difficult no you ever heard?
Boy, oh boy. I almost didn't get Don Cherry. We were getting really close to the finish line. I'd done 3 auditions in 3 different cities in 2 countries. I did a makeup test and everything. And when I was waiting for the call to, you know, tell me that I got it or not, I instead got a call from a buddy saying that he'd just auditioned for it. So that wrecked me pretty good. That wasn't fun. But yeah, you know, there's things along the way. You just got to battle through it.
In that call, is the buddy aware that you were up for it?
Yeah, he was, and he...
It was kind of like a courtesy call?
Yeah, it was. He was looking out for me there. He wanted me to hear it from him rather than hear it from somebody else.
It was interesting, as I was going through and just sort of looking at your acting credits, and you worked pretty steadily, like, from about 2007 on.
Yep, I've had some luck.
Yeah, I actually was surprised that you were in Godzilla, which is kind of interesting to me, just because I remember when that movie came out, Bryan Cranston, whatever, and you had a small role, but it was a speaking role. And
yeah, I was there. I was hanging out.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Well, this is why I bring it up, for, like, a big studio movie like that, when you get the call, they're like, yeah, it's happening. Was there a feeling associated with it? Were you like, oh, it's another, you know, in a line of jobs I've been doing and keeping it rolling?
It's a big one because it's a big paycheck. You know, when you're on a big movie like that, you certainly factor those things in. You're not going to be doing much. It's going to be boring as hell, and it's going to be soul sucking. But it's money, and you need money to eat, right? So you take those jobs and you do the best you can. Maybe you'll impress the director and want to beef up your part, something like that. You consider all the angles.
Have you sort of traditionally, I don't want to say had difficulty, but with sort of managing like commerce and creative, meaning like it is a business, even though we're creating something really fun and honest and true, but we have to monetize it.
As far as like building a brand goes, you certainly don't want to become, you know, if say you're Wayne's World, yeah, you don't want to become Noah's Arcade presents Wayne's World, right? So, you know, we're always kind of careful of not having too much Letterkenny, you know?
Now you guys are 5 seasons deep.
Yeah.
I guess my question would be, after sort of those 5 seasons, when we talked, initially it was like the first 6 episode order. Do you find that as your life has changed, it's easy to sort of still write those characters and stay connected to sort of what it was that originally spawned the show?
I still spend a lot of time in the country and in small towns and stuff. So you draw from things that you see back there. I don't think that it's become harder to write Letterkenny. I think that eventually it will become hard as I dry up a little bit creatively. We're doing 14 episodes a year now, and that's a lot of work. But our writing team is growing and growing, and that makes my job a lot easier. You know, the scripts that we get from Jonathan Torrens and Trevor Risk and Sonia Bennett out west, Lynn Cam, Jesse McEwen, we get really good scripts from these guys, you know, so there's not a lot of work for me to do in my passes now.
When you brought in these writers, these other writers who weren't there maybe initially,
yeah,
was that like, wow, this is a real benefit of success, or is it like, I've always respected the hell out of this person's work, I need to bring them into the fold?
Well, Jonathan Torrens is a guy, it's a dream scenario there. He's a guy that I would watch on Trailer Park Boys.
Did you watch Jonovision before that?
I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, growing up, I watched a bit of Jonovision. I never saw him on Street Sense, but the J-Rock scenes in Trailer Park Boys, we would, my pals and I out west, we would rewind those scenes and watch them again and again. So I'd say that Torrens is my pound for pound favorite Canadian. So to have him on the writing team now, and he's going to be in the next season as well on screen, that's a dream come true for me. That's the number one guy. That's the number one human being on planet Earth that I would want to work with, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you mentioned Trailer Park Boys, and one of the things we were talking about when we were talking about having this conversation was there's lots of, like, sort of, or we can sort of name comedies that have taken place in small towns in Canada. What do you think separates Letterkenny from things like, I guess, like a Corner Gas or a Trailer Park Boys or any other comp you could come up with?
The pace, I think, is something we're a show that you could call overwritten, I think. But I think that that's one of our strengths. It's one of the things that sets us apart, is just the pace of the dialogue, the clip of it. It's something that worked in the web series for us, just prioritizing laughs on a second-to-second basis. And when making the transition from 2-minute YouTube sketches to 30-minute episodic, yeah, I didn't want to change that formula at all. While I'm writing it, I have to stay stimulated, right? Or why would I do it? So I really just try to keep things moving at an impossible clip, but we've been able to maintain it so far.
Yeah, well, when you're like, when the joke count is as high as, like you said, on a 2-minute YouTube clip where it's like bang, 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 yeah, was that a serious challenge to stretch that out to 30 minutes?
Yeah, but it's a fun challenge.
Sure.
You know? And again, our team of writers, I gotta give a stick tap there because they get it.
Well, actually, last time we talked, you mentioned Rushmore and Snatch.
Yeah.
As sort of big influences, mostly, you know, you were talking about the music montages and telling a story without any dialogue and just like those, yeah, slow motion moving things. In the time since we talked in those initial 6 episodes, has there been a conscious effort to experiment in other sort of visual styles? Do you not want to mess with the secret sauce? Have there been other influences you pulled in over the years?
We've kind of been taking risks since season one that way. You know, in season one, we took a risk with Fart Book. That was pretty high concept. And then in the second season, we did a spoof on Dragon's Den Shark Tank. So I think that we're always taking risks, but as far as the actual filmmaking goes, what Jacob Tierney does as our director, it ain't broke, so we're not going to try to fix it yet. We're not going to try to go too far out of our wheelhouse, but we'll always try to keep pushing the envelope one way or another.
Because you're so hands-on, like, with the whole process from the beginning until now, I guess my question would be, like, when it comes to things like just promos you have to do for the show or press or this sort of bigger mechanism or machine that it comes to when you have a show as successful as Letterkenny, how do you view that? Do you view it as like a necessity, like, oh, I need to go out and have these conversations, I got to promote, or do you see it as like an exciting opportunity? I just always wonder how creatives frame that part of the job.
I don't see any of it necessary, actually. I'm glad you asked that question. It's something for me, my approach to this business is that, you know, you get into it even as an actor and you're told that there's things that you have to do. And I've never had it in any of my acting contracts that I have to do a red carpet or that I have to do an interview that I don't want to do. It's just something that I've done. And, you know, I've gotten to a place now where I've had those opportunities. I've had the press opportunities, and now I feel better about passing those opportunities to my cast. I've got this great big cast that works so hard for us, and I would like them to have the exposure. I think that they've earned it. But there's certain things in the business that, you know, it's whatever gives you a thrill. And if you like getting dressed up and walking a red carpet, more power to you. Got no problem with that. I just don't see it necessary, personally.
As one of the, I guess, the leaders on the show, you know,
yeah.
Do you even think about, like you said, you mentioned the cast, you're going to be you want them to have these opportunities. Like, no, you guys go to the press, get a little bit of shine.
Yeah.
Do you think about leadership style at all? I mean, this kind of pertains to sports, too. There's different styles, right? There's lead by example. Then there's sort of like, I'm going to pull you aside, we're going to have a conversation. Do you have sort of an ethos or like a way you approach it?
Yeah, yeah. I definitely like to lead by example. I don't really know what the definition of that is, but I think if you want to break it down, if you want to keep it simple, you just be nice. You be polite. You remember people's names. It's really that simple, and it's something that kind of gets lost along the way. I think people forget their manners. And if you're nice and polite and reasonable, I think people are going to have an easier time following your lead. And that stuff's contagious as well. So, yeah, just be kind, I guess, at the end of the day.
It's a simple message, but I think it's difficult for some people. People get in their own head, or there's insecurity, and it gets weird. But I think that's more rare than it is common, especially with someone that's, you know, the star of a successful TV show.
Hey, there's a lot of dicks in the film business, man. Yeah, there's a ton of dicks in this business. You know, you got to be careful with that, because, like, if you think there's so many dicks around you, maybe you're the dick, right? But there's... a lot of hyperbole in this business when you're describing people, because you ask somebody, you know, how's this person to work with? And somebody's either going to say, oh my God, are they nice? They are so cool. Oh my God, the coolest person on earth. Or they're going to say, biggest dick I've ever met in my life. You've never met a bigger dick in your life. There is no bigger dick on planet Earth. There's no one out there. Just say, it's okay. One or the other. It's the extreme. So I know which end of the stick I want to be on, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, okay. So, you know, it's funny. We had a question about, I guess, the Canadian television and film industry in general, right? And it's a pretty small group. It tends to attract a certain personality type. And I think you just kind of summed up the way that people speak in these circles and how they are. Do you feel very outsider to that? Do you feel like you're able to navigate that world? Do you mind navigating it?
How do you mean? Like with...
outside of the people you choose to do your work with, whether it's the cast or Jacob Tierney. Yeah. It's like, I think there's a certain amount of like socializing that has to go on in order to succeed and sort of network and navigate the tapestry of the industry.
Oh, okay.
That's where I'm getting.
Yeah, gotcha. Well, there's more than one way to skin the cat, that's for sure. You can make your way in this business by being an auditioner or a schmoozer. And both are very valid, both very viable options. But I know that I would rather be an auditioner. I would rather be the person that the work gets me onto set, not going through a party. There's lots of people who make their way up by schmoozing, and there's nothing wrong with that. You can absolutely make your way up by schmoozing, but it's not one of my strengths. Auditioning and preparing is how I did it, and that's certainly how people get on our show, get on Letterkenny. You know, there's so many things too, like, you don't get many opportunities to talk about this stuff, or I don't allow myself many opportunities to talk about this stuff. But there are so many good young actors in Canada. It's super, super tough when we put out these casting calls, all the young actors that are sending us tapes and stuff. One thing I should say is we've never looked at a headshot. We've never looked at a resume. It's all the tape. Mm. It's all the work. And it's super, super tough to choose between all these young actors. We got a super impressive talent pool here.
One of the things I want to talk about, and we touched a bit on comedy and sensibility, and like you said, dick jokes. My question was going to be, the comedy climate has changed a lot. I think there's a lot of comedians rethinking how they're phrasing things, what material they can do.
Yeah.
Are you conscious of that as you guys write now? And I mean, I don't think you guys have ever had any issues with sort of, I guess, what are the relevant conversations right now surrounding a lot of the sort of like, I guess, more sensitive subjects in the world and things you can joke about. Are you really aware of that when you guys are writing?
I think that there's a pretty concrete line there. You know, what with Jacob and I and our writing team, we're, like I said, we're always trying to push that limit. But there's I think a very solid line that you shouldn't cross. One of the battles that we decided to pick this year is we wanted to say the C word. When we went to Bell and said, you know, we're going into season 5 here. We know you don't like us to say this word. We would really like to say this word exactly 11 times. And they come back and like, guys, it's been literally the only rule since day one. You can't say the C word. And now you're asking us to say it. It's like, that's exactly what we're doing. And they said, okay. So our partnership with our execs at Bell, the leash gets looser and looser every year, gaining more and more of their trust along the way is something I'm very proud of.
Trust is also something that you sort of acquire through success. And you guys have been super successful.
Yeah.
You know, like with that kind of success though, does come a certain type of security. I would imagine it might be different for you, but I guess early on when you're like, oh, we got this show, we want it to work. And you know, all of these things that go into making something successful. Now that you are in like a good secure place, like you said, 2 more years, what gives you anxiety now? You know, like, do you still have those creative anxieties, or is there like other things that you're like, this stuff feels pretty good, we can park this? Like, what concerns you now that that's a bit out of the way?
You ask cool questions, man. what gives me anxiety now is, what doesn't give me anxiety now? Nothing creatively, nothing attached to Letterkenny. We have found such a cool spot there. We've carved out such a comfortable place, a creative space. I enjoy every single second of that. What do I worry about though? What do I, like, what gives me anxiety? Like literally just about everything else. Not serious anxiety, not like crippling anxiety. I'm pretty lucky there, but like, if there's something to worry about, I'll worry about it.
Yeah. Just a natural worrier.
Why not just make your life a little more difficult if you've got, if you've got a sec to do that? Yeah.
I kind of also wanted to ask, like, because obviously, you know, Letterkenny's been this sort of like rocket ship. Do you ever think about, what am I going to do next? Do I want to do other things next? And is this role going to sort of define me going forward, positively or negatively? Or is it even a concern?
Well, we've got this for the next 3 years. I would like to do this for the next 33 years. And people say, no, you won't. But yes, I will. I think I've got a pretty good idea of what I want and what makes me happy. And this show does it all for me. You know, I know that there may come a time when the people that work on the show might want to try something else. That's something I absolutely understand. But it took me over a decade to get here, to get to this spot where I have literally everything I need in this business. And so I'd like to keep that going for as long as I can, you know. And I guess if I were to set a goal, it would be to try to be the longest running Canadian show of all time, you know. And I'll try to find a way to do it one way or another, but I'm truly happy doing this. So, yeah, hopefully I can maintain it.
You guys just expanded to Hulu, and you had this killer review in Rolling Stone by Alan Sepinwall, who I actually think is a really great critic. Are you someone that reads reviews?
Oh, yeah.
You are, okay. Because some people will lie and be like, nah, fuck, I don't mess with that.
Yeah, I read absolutely everything. I think it's important to keep your finger on the pulse there. I'm not someone who gets too affected by the negative things, just because I'm confident in Letterkenny and in the product that we're putting forward. I'm certainly open to criticism and critiques, but when we got that Rolling Stone interview, I got that blown up and framed for everybody in the cast. But for me personally, it was really, really special because I subscribed to Rolling Stone and Spin and Maxim, if I'm being completely honest, in the day.
I guess lastly, as we wrap this, I mean, I feel like you answered. I was going to ask about the future because when we talked initially, Nate said, and I think he was joking, but he said, I was like, what do you want for Letterkenny after these initial 6 episodes?
Yeah.
And he said 25 seasons and 6 or 7 movies.
Yeah, we'll make a movie for sure.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
It's going to go down.
Yeah. Yeah, but big time.
You could see doing 25 years. I mean, you said 33 seasons already. So.
Hey, if I can, I would like to. And again, people say no. There's no way you'll want to. But I really do think that I will. If I ask the bosses upstairs politely, maybe they'll grant that.
Well, I think you'll get whatever you want, man.
Oh, thanks very much, Mike. Yeah,
I appreciate you doing this.
Hey, thank you.
Seriously, honestly,
means the world.
Oh,
man.
Thanks. It's a team effort, man. Yeah.
Thank you to Jared Keeso, possibly the nicest man in the entertainment industry.
Thanks a lot.
Oh, sorry, my friend. But this is your segment. This is what we call the dessert.
You even have your own mug.
Yeah.
I do.
That's right.
Yeah.
I like this mug. This is really nice.
They fucked it up, to be honest, because I had a better mug than this with the logo slightly bigger, but I sold them at a live show we did, and I got them to remake it, but they made it too small. So I'm not happy.
And how much are you selling them for?
$20.
And what's it cost you to make it?
$22.
He's a pop culture aficionado, not a business aficionado.
He's not a business aficionado. No. What did you call it, though? An investment in advertising?
I said you're spending $2 a mug on advertising for yourself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Spend money to make money.
I think that's these right. One day will be a hot item.
I do,
as
too.
For now, I'm just taking a loss. But this one today is about Grammy Award winner Jason Mraz. He had just come out as being bisexual.
There's a big news story that week.
Every news outlet was asking about it. So I.
But he's the kind of guy that seemed open to talk about it.
I know that now.
Okay.
At the time, I was like, this is a bit of a risk. Do you ask someone about their sexuality in the confines of a comedic segment? I decided to take the risk, but I found a pretty good segue.
There is no right or wrong way to wear a hat.
You are bisexual.
Yes.
He really opened up about it.
Okay.
Some might call him an oversharer,
actually. That's just cool, though.
But yeah, it didn't go well in the room, per se.
Okay.
It was very awkward, but we have a slogan in Digital Desserts, bad in the room, good in the edit.
Okay. Mm.
In fact, the camera person right here, he approached Jason afterwards, and he said, I'm so sorry. He goes, I didn't know he was going to do that. And I was like, oh, you don't tell the guy that he's going to want to destroy the footage or something.
Sure.
Luckily, that didn't happen. But also luckily, we played this at a live show that we did.
Yeah.
Gangbusters.
It People went great. Loved it. People did love it.
They did.
People were hooting. And
what's an example of a hoot? Like Arsenio?
Yeah, he started it. These people
brought it back 20 years later.
They brought it back. And then at the end, just to exaggerate a little bit, it was kind of like a scene out of Hard Day's Night.
Where they're chasing you down the street?
Except instead of young ladies, it was like comedy nerds just chasing me. Like, I digress, because you just have to see it for yourself. Enjoy. Jason Mraz, Shane's Digital Dessert.
Talk to that camera.
Okay.
Hi, my name...
This camera?
This camera.
All right.
Hi, my name is Shane, and this is Shane's Digital Dessert. A lot of people say my guest today is soft, but I say he's always got a hat on. Pop legend Jason Mraz.
I'm yours. That's right. I wear many hats.
Some people may not know that you actually run an avocado ranch.
I do. I call it the Maranch.
I hear you donate the blemished avocados to soup kitchens.
I have. Wind fall causes fruit to fall out of the trees. Now, it's illegal to sell those fruits, but it is not illegal to donate.
So you're kind of forced into charity there.
Exactly.
Do you ever hear from maybe a disgruntled homeless person who's like, why am I being subjected to these subpar avocados?
No, they're not rotten.
When I do an interview, I always try to help the artist in some way.
Okay.
So I'm trying to add a little bit of badassness to your image.
Okay, sure.
I was thinking I could hold up pictures of people in popular culture and you could like throw them a little diss.
Okay.
You're willing to try that?
Yeah, how do I see them?
I have them on me, actually. Okay, so this one's easy.
Lucifer.
This is one of the most bad guys ever.
Who polishes your horns? They sure are shiny.
Just have at it. I mean, it is Satan.
The costume designer had to macrame that.
Okay, we're skipping this one.
I'm envious of that look.
This one I thought might get you a little
riled. Is that Martin Short?
Oh, that's a diss. This is a woman.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Hitler.
Yikes.
If you say a good thing about him, that's going to go viral in the wrong way.
I'm not saying a good thing at all. Where'd you get that mustache?
Ouch. Yeah, because it is a shit mustache.
Those are just nose hairs. Hanging out.
You're talking to him still, right?
Yeah, sorry.
This one, now it's getting a little harder.
Oh, man. Hey, big fella. Oh, he's so cute. I'm mostly a cat person. Check me out.
Okay. This guy, I thought you might really have some anger
Jack
towards.
Jack Johnson.
He's your competition.
He's like Curious George.
Ooh.
But that's a good thing.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. I was actually listening to your album today, and I couldn't spot a swear word.
Thank you for noticing. I just want to be mindful of the art that I'm putting out there in the world, because I know people of all ages are listening, especially young people.
Are you just like, hey, I'm never going to swear in public?
Oh, fuck no.
Whoa.
Yeah.
I was going to try to get you to say the P or S word.
Oh, what's the P word?
Pissed.
Oh.
The S word's shit. You probably knew that.
Oh, yeah. I would rather be like a Mr. Rogers character than a...
Mr. T?
I don't think he sweared.
He said cunt in one episode
he
of the
A-Team. Did?
I peed a f***.
It was an outtake.
Right.
Though. But you won't say cunt, will you?
No, I can't do that.
I was wondering if you'd be willing to help me with my struggle with hats.
Okay.
Am I doing something wrong, or am I not just a hat person?
Sure, let's see it. Wow, it fits in your pocket. Okay, yeah.
Am I wearing this wrong, or?
There is no right or wrong way to wear a hat. The hat is an extension of the hat wearer. That means the subject has the opportunity to describe the piece as good or not.
You are bisexual.
Yes.
You told your wife that you were sleeping with other men. My wife would flip out if I told her that.
Well, I came right home and I told her. I said, so I hooked up with a guy. I said, but know that had it been a woman that was the last person at this party, odds are I could have hooked up with her too. So I want you to know that it wasn't gender specific. It was a spontaneous act.
Wow, she must have been so relieved.
Right. That was the initial sort of conversation. And that led to a conversation about trust.
I would bet. Well, are you allowed to anymore, or have the rules set in?
Yeah, if I do, I tell her, because secrets are toxic.
Especially yours. Jeez.
I said, I want you to know who you're dating.
A cheater.
Cheating would be having urges that you don't share with your partner.
Yeah, okay, I guess that is it. So I think honesty kind of is badass.
Honesty is.
Jason Mraz, good guy, badass?
Hey.
And then we usually dance off kind of awkwardly.
Okay.
That was Shane's Digital Dessert with Jason Mraz. Thank you to Jason for being a good sport and hanging out with Shane.
Little known fact, I covered a Jason Mraz song in high school.
What was it?
The Remedy, the first big one.
Really?
Yeah. There was a period of time when it was, is it Jason Mraz or John Mayer? Which camp are you in? It was like Tupac and Biggie in my high school.
Oh, I think iconically people most often compare Jason Mraz and John Mayer to Tupac and Biggie.
That was the narrative back then, man.
What, how white was your high school?
It was mostly Asian, to be honest.
Oh, interesting. Yeah,
whatever.
Okay, Toronto. Yeah. You went to school in Toronto.
Yeah, downtown.
Yeah, okay. So thank you to Jason Mraz for coming on. Thank you to Jared Keeso for being so kind and sitting down with us, because I know he's not a big fan of doing the press. All right, guys, see you next episode. And like we say on our podcast, see you next week if we don't die on the weekend.